Chapter 1 was swinging down your flight path. Chapter 2 is directing the club face. That was quite a bit of information in Chapter 2. So here we go. The first illustration in Chapter 2. Bend your long shots for better consistency. To make long shots fly straight time after time takes more precise skill than even expert golfers possess. Therefore, assuming that most shots will curve, either right or left, it does not pay to play for a straight shot with wood clubs or the longer shafted irons. The drawing at right shows that if you play for a straight shot, dashed line, and then curve it in either direction, solid lines, the ball will always fly, bounce, and roll away from the target. The smart golfer plays his woods and long irons to curve in a given direction, either from right to left, or as shown here, from left to right. Then if the ball doesn't curve as much as expected, solid arrow on the right, it still will curve, bounce, and roll toward the target. If it curves more than expected, solid arrow on the left, it still won't miss the target by as much as it would have if the player had not anticipated any curve in that direction. In this chapter, I will explain how to adjust your setup alignment and club face aim to play for shots that curve slightly. Experts can curve shots at will in either direction. Less skillful players should, at first, learn to master the art of curving shots in one direction only. Ball will curve where club face is looking. To a certain extent, the direction in which the club face happens to be looking when the ball leaves it determines the direction in which it will curve in flight. If it is looking to the right of the path on which it is moving, top drawing, the ball will start out more or less on that path and then curve to the right. If the club face looks in the same direction as it is moving, middle drawing, the ball will fly straight in whatever direction that path of movement happens to be. If the club face looks left of its path of movement, bottom drawing, the ball will eventually curve to the left of that path. Now I might just add my own footnote here. The ball flight laws are better understood than when this was written. And they've determined that the direction which the club face is looking is the stronger determination of the initial flight path rather than the direction of the swing path. Clubhead path helps determine clubhead facing. If you don't manipulate the club face open to the right or closed to the left with independent hand and wrist action, the direction in which it faces through impact will tend to more or less coincide with the direction in which it swings. Therefore, the more the club head is moving around a rim, drawing at left, when it swings through impact, the more its facing will turn from right to left. It will tend to face down the flight path for only the instant when it is actually moving down that path. You'll feel this turning from right to left if you put your left hand in front of you, as shown, and swing it around a rim in front of you. That's the top drawing. Again, since the club face tends to look in the direction in which the club head moves through impact, the more it swings on a straight edge instead of around a rim, the longer it will face in one direction. It will hold its facing instead of turning from right to left. You'll sense this resistance to turning if you simulate the straight edge swing with your left hand representing the club head, as shown in the drawing here. Be sure to start by aligning yourself to the left. Then swing your hand outside your flight path at the start of your backswing and along it on your forward swing. That's the bottom picture. Left hand dominance. While golf is a two-handed game, most golfers need more control of the club with the left hand. Holding on firmly with the last three fingers of this hand helps to keep the club face looking in your proper direction through impact. right-hand dominance. Too much right-hand dominance or too little left-hand control allows the right hand to take over during the downswing. Then, during impact, it will have misaligned the club face and also perhaps have flipped the club face upward into the ball. Acceleration aids left-hand control. Left-hand control through impact is more likely to occur if the left arm continues accelerating forward. Such acceleration is more likely to happen if you slide laterally at the start of your downswing and thereby drop the club onto an inside rim. Starting out by aligning to the left makes the lateral slide much easier. This chain reaction is shown in the top row of drawings. The bottom row shows the opposite of the opposite set of reactions. Aligning to the right forces you to spin to the left, back toward your target, which causes spinning instead of lateral sliding. The spinning produces a left arm deceleration, which gives the right hand a chance to take over and misalign the club face and or flip it forward. So just a quick review there. The top is the proper way, aligning left, lateral slide, left arm acceleration, and left hand control. Now the improper way, bottom row, aligning right, spinning out, left arm deceleration, and then right hand control causing the flip. Okay, now the grip. Trevino gives 4 steps to a proper grip. And I'm not really even going to cover this because this is basically, he just reiterates, which is traditional things about the grip. And in fact, as I'll read in the text, which is actually more important, this advice actually contradicts what he does. Because as is shown here, the very weak left-hand grip, and he's emphasizes always the back of the left hand and the club face alignment. But while he emphasizes that, that's not actually what he does. Here he shows 3 ways to join your hands to the club. Which is just your traditional 10-finger grip, overlap grip, and interlock grip. But now here's the important thing. Here on page 74, he says, I think this hand club face alignment also gives you best chance for making your hands return to a strong position at impact. By a strong position, I again mean one in which the left hand leads the club face slightly in the race back to the ball. Now, I know some readers are going to say that Trevino doesn't practice what he preaches when it comes to aligning the left hand and the club face. In a sense, they'd be right, because while I do start out by holding the club with the back of my left hand aligned with the leading edge of the face, I then regrip just before I start the club head back. I turn my hand slightly to my right on the club without changing the aiming of the club face. I do this for 2 reasons. First, it's a way I have of breaking tension in my hands and arms. Second, it puts my hands in a position that would cause me to hook the ball badly to the left if I should happen to roll my wrist too much to the left through impact. Here again, by re-gripping into a hooker's grip, I put myself on the brink of disaster so that I'll be sure to react in only one way, in a way that keeps me from closing the door with my club face through impact. In short, the hooker's grip forces me not to let the club face close, and that again helps to keep it looking in the same direction as it is traveling a little bit longer through impact. But this regripping is an idiosyncrasy that I wouldn't expect or want anyone else to try. Regripping would probably ruin another golfer's sense of rhythm or his sense of club face control. I mention here only to explain why my grip doesn't look quite the way I'm telling you yours should look. The last thing I want to emphasize about gripping, which I do stress in my own game, is that as you hold the club, you should feel that you're controlling it primarily in the last three fingers of your left hand. Keep your right hand very soft on the club. And if you waggle the club head before you swing, make sure you do the waggling chiefly with these last three fingers of your left hand. So here I'm going to add my own two cents about the grip, because there's no way that you could imitate Lee Trevino's swing unless you have the strong left-hand grip that he does, and the right hand is pretty strong too under the shaft. If you watch how he regrips the club, and there's actually science to this. The science, I've seen video of Mac O'Grady, and when he talks about having the strong left-hand grip, Mac O'Grady explains is that with a strong left-hand grip, there's actually much less moving parts in your wrist and forearm as you come in through impact. And so my take on that is that that's one of the things that really actually helped Trevino keep both his club path and the club face alignment in the direction that he wanted it to have that slightly longer, through impact control of the club face. So my advice would be if you're trying to apply the things that Lee Trevino teaches, don't use the weak traditional grip that he's recommending here, but actually go ahead and look at video of Lee Trevino and stop it and watch when he re-grips it, and that would actually be the grip to take. Now, if you don't want to re-grip, which I don't, I'll actually take that stronger grip right from the get-go, which is the grip that he has after he's re-gripped it, just before he starts the club back. So don't do as Trevino preaches here, but do as he does if you want to have any chance of imitating his technique. You react in your swing to where you've aimed. If you aim your club face to the right of your target, as many golfers do, you'll tend to subconsciously roll your wrist from right to left counterclockwise as you swing through the ball. This radically changes the facing of the club head during a relatively short span of movement. It reduces the span during which your club head is actually facing down the flight path. Just as the standard rim swing minimizes the span when the club head is moving down that path, any slight mistiming will make the club face look left or right at impact. If you aim your club face to the left of your flight path, as I do, your wrists will not turn the club face from right to left so radically through impact. Instead, to avoid hitting the shot to the left where you've aimed, you will tend to hold your on-path club face alignment slightly longer as it swings through the ball. This increases your chances of making your club face look in the right direction at the right time. The degree to which you should aim to the left depends on whether you normally slice or hook your shots. You'll find the aim and alignment that's best for you by referring to the next set of illustrations. Finding the aim that's best for you. You have two choices when it comes to altering the way your shots curve in the air. You can either change your alignment by aligning your feet and body more or less to the left than you have been, or you can change the direction in which you're aiming the back of your left hand, and thus your club face alignment. Since every player swings a bit differently from everyone else, I can't tell you exactly where to align and aim, so I'll give you some general guidelines on these pages. I do suggest, however, that you start by aligning your feet and body about the same amount to the left of your flight path as you aim the back of your left hand and the club face. You'll notice this relationship is shown in the drawing above, where everything is aligned and aimed 30 degrees left of the flight path. That's this illustration here. To decrease hooking, aim further left. It may sound strange to aim further left to cure shots that are already flying too far to the left. However, as I explained earlier, if you aim further left, you will instinctively prevent your wrist from rolling the club face to the left, which is what causes hooking in the first place. To decrease slicing, align less to the left. You may be slicing from left to right because your club head is swinging down to the ball along an outside rim, thereby cutting across the ball and giving it a left-to-right side spin. By aligning your feet and body less to the left, you'll improve your chances of swinging back to the ball from the inside to along your flight path. To decrease slicing, aim less to the left. The less you aim the club face to the left, the less you'll fear hitting the ball to the left. This will cause you to react by rolling your wrist more freely from right to left through the impact area. The extra wrist rolling will help cure slicing. To decrease hooking, align more to the left. If your hooking comes from swinging back to the ball on a rim that's too far inside your flight path, aligning farther to the left will bring that path back to normal. The normal clubhead path will reduce your wrist rolling to the left, which had been causing your hooking in that direction. So here's our summary of Chapter 2, Summary of Club Face Alignment. In the first chapter, on controlling the clubhead's path, I told you how to extend its movement down the initial flight path by doing four things. 1. Aligning to the left of that path. 2. Starting the club back along this alignment outside the flight path. 3. Dropping the club into the slot by sliding the hips and legs laterally to the left at the start of the downswing turn by shifting weight from the right foot onto the outside ball of the left. And 4. Extending the left arm out away from the body and down the flight path through impact and beyond. In this second chapter on controlling the club head's facing through impact, I suggested 1. Holding the club with the back of the left hand aligned with the leading edge of the club face. 2. At first aiming the club face in the same direction you've aligned, and then modifying this relationship according to the curve you want your shots to take. 3. Controlling the club with the last three fingers of your left hand, both at address and throughout the swing. And 4. Maintaining this left hand control by accelerating your hips, legs, and left arm forward as you swing through impact. Remember, it's left-hand control combined with swinging the club head on line longer that keeps the club face looking in the right direction longer through impact. It's left arm acceleration that helps you maintain left-hand control. And it's the open alignment and the lateral slide that allow you to make this acceleration. End of chapter 2. Chapter 3 will be Finding Ball Level.